The first step in a lot of experiments when we want to study sex differences is to ground the hard tissue. Put on the protected glass equipment, some of the liquid nitrogen into the mortar and pestle, and at the same time I will take the frozen mouse heart and put it in there. Similar with the cooking, when you ground spices, it also helps to release certain fragrance and aroma. So in the context of the heart, it helps to release some compounds that we are interested in. It's pretty hard, and sometimes, you know, the heart would jump out of the mortar if I don't really cover it. Now when it's liquefied, it goes in here, we close it, and the sample is ready for the analysis. So what used to be a solid heart is right now converted into a fine powder.
Lukas Schmatal is a researcher at the Page Laboratory at MIT's Whitehead Institute, who studies sex differences in the heart. Sex is usually defined by several biological attributes, including genetic and anatomical features and hormone levels, and it exists on a spectrum. It's separate from gender, which is defined by social and cultural characteristics and also exists on a spectrum. As shorthand, we'll refer to typical female individuals on the sex spectrum as women, and typical male individuals on it as men. Heart disease kills more people of all sexes than anything else. But for more women than men, a heart attack may start with nausea, shortness of breath, and extreme fatigue, rather than chest pain. These symptoms are still often thought of as atypical, which means many women don't get the treatment they need in time.
Science is not a view from nowhere. It's made by flawed people that are people in their times, that are people who have certain investments in making a certain type of knowledge that underpins the society they're in. Anatomy doesn't change all that much over time, but when you have a new lens, new ideas, and new people with diverse perspectives come into the field, you're actually making a ton of discoveries.
I would say right from the beginning of working in this lab, I was just really surprised to know that we don't understand this really fundamental aspect of our human biology, which is how do the differences in our genomes between males and females affect our health. This is a difference we've known about for decades, and it's really been overlooked. There is a growing group of people who are very interested in these questions, and many of them are women.
My awesome lady scientist who has great PPE, but no shoes.
Adriana San Roman studies skin and blood samples from individuals who are neither XX nor XY at the Page Lab.
The human body contains somewhere between 30 and 40 trillion cells, and each one of your cells has an entire copy of all of your DNA, including those sex chromosomes. We talk about this binary of males and females, but actually the way that these different factors come together, thinking about DNA and hormones, that can actually vary a lot in the human population. By collecting samples from individuals with all different numbers of X and Y chromosomes, we've been able to really quantitatively ask, okay, how does the number of X or Y chromosomes in a cell really affect its function? In my system, the idea is to take these cells out of the body, culture them in a dish where they're no longer exposed to hormones. And so we can really get at that question of how the DNA and the sex chromosomes are contributing. So these are all patient samples. So every one of these flasks is a sample from a different individual. And so now we have our cells. There's a little stripe of cells. You can barely see it right at the bottom there, but that's actually a lot of cells. That's probably, 5 to 10 million skin cells just in that tiny little bit. And this little circly part here, this kind of lighter circle, this is the nucleus where the DNA is in this cell. And you can see that here as well in this cell. we have cells in the gut that need to absorb nutrients from the foods that we eat. We have cells in our muscle that work to create the mechanical forces that we need to move our bodies. And it's possible that if that instruction manual is slightly different, the way that they do their jobs might actually be different and contribute to these differences in health that we see.
For a very long time, there's sort of been this sense that a female is just a small male. When you're asking your biological question, you've got to take off the blinkers and be thinking, you know, about both sexes, even when you're pretty darn certain that actually sex is not going to impact what's going on. Just don't be so sure.
Jackie White is a researcher at Jackson Laboratory, one of the world's largest suppliers of lab mice. To date, 24 Nobel Prizes have been awarded for research using Jackson Laboratory mice. In the US, about 95% of mammals used in biomedical research are rodents, because they're very similar genetically to humans.
If we don't get it right at the beginning of the pipeline, what's going to filter down that pipeline are drugs coming out the other end that aren't fit for purpose.
In 1977, the Food and Drug Administration recommended that women of childbearing age be excluded from early clinical trials because of the possibility that medications could have side effects on a fetus. But excluding female subjects led to other side effects. In January 2001, less than a decade after the FDA reversed its recommendation, 8 of the 10 drugs it pulled from the market over the previous 4 years had worse side effects in female individuals.
And the sense was, if we'd got it right in the first instance, we could have saved an awful lot of time and made things an awful lot safer. So it just felt like the time was right to try and really put out a study like this that said, you know, sex matters.
In 2017, White and her team published data breaking down sexual dimorphism, or differences between males and females, in more than 14,000 wild-type mice and more than 40,000 mutant ones. In the unaltered mice, they found that sex influenced more than half of continuous traits, such as bone mineral density, and about 1 in 10 categorical traits, such as the shape of whiskers.
We were surprised by just how many. And also, looking at the traits a priori, you wouldn't necessarily have guessed that they were going to be sexually dimorphic. And so at the front of the eye, there's a structure called the cornea. What can happen is that cornea can cloud over. So the phenotype is called corneal opacity. And what we found was corneal opacity was more prevalent in female animals than male animals.
Then they took it one step further by looking at the more than 40,000 mice that had a gene switched off or knocked out to see what happened.
So you're looking at the subset for which there is a difference thanks to the knockout, and we're saying, are the males and females the same or are they different?
They found the male and female knockout animals to be different in more than 1 in 6 resulting continuous traits, such as grip strength and glucose tolerance, and in more than 1 in 8 resulting categorical changes. White says it would be a mistake to assume that humans don't harbor similar sex differences.
So, you know, it's not right to think of diseases as uniformly affecting the human population.
Rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, multiple sclerosis, these diseases are more common in females than in males. And there are, in fact, examples of this kind across every area of disease, every part of the body.
David Page founded the Page Lab in 1984 to study the impact of sex chromosomes on cells across the body.
Biomedical researchers have for a very long time viewed those sex differences as a kind of inconvenience that should be ignored and simply gets in the way of research. Many scientists thought that the ovarian cycle could be a source of noise. And the thought was, oh, well, males are much more predictable. They don't show any instabilities of this sort, which is, of course, ridiculous. You know, perhaps at some other level, just a placing of greater value upon improving the health of males than of females.
In 1993, Congress passed a law requiring the inclusion of women in all clinical research funded by the National Institutes of Health. But in 2019, only 42% of articles in the biological sciences that included both males and females analyzed data by sex. One study found that only 7% of reports on adverse drug reactions to heart failure medication gave data separately for women and men, and about half of them showed significant differences.
The Book of Life, the rule book for building our bodies, is made up of this substance called DNA. The whole book is called the genome, but each of the chapters in the book is called a chromosome. Actually, the first 45 chapters in each of our books is exactly the same in males and females. It's just chapter 46. And the X and the Y have been an object of fascination by biologists and geneticists for a century. But for most of that century, we've gotten it wrong. So the old view was that if the fetus was XY, it developed testes. But if the fetus was XX, it developed ovaries. And if the fetus developed testes, then you got big T, testosterone. If instead it had ovaries, you got estrogen. And that the thought was that testosterone or estrogen took over the task of masculinizing or feminizing the whole rest of the body. This is the way that it has been taught, and I would argue is still taught in almost all medical schools and universities around the world today. But we're now arguing that these arrows need to be drawn in the heart, in the lungs, in the liver, in the blood, and not just in some of the cells, but in virtually all the cells of our body that make up those organs. What is the relative impact of that 46th chromosome, be it a second X or a Y, as compared with testosterone or estrogen, or environmental or behavioral or social factors? All of these clearly come into play, and they all come into play at the same time. Separating them and teasing apart their impacts and getting a sense of their relative consequence is a big, big question for the future. We don't have a clue at present.
There are many ways in which gender can affect health outcomes. One study suggests that middle-aged women, for instance, are twice as likely as middle-aged men with the same symptoms of heart disease to be instead diagnosed with a mental health condition. The Page Lab, though, is trying to tease out the influence of sex.
One of the techniques that we can use is basically to take a snapshot of all of our genes that are on or off in the cells that we're looking at. And we can kind of get a picture of the types of, you know, molecular machines that these cells are making and how that is affected by the chromosomes. And so each of these dots on this plot is one of our individual cell samples. And this is actually from those blood cells that I was showing you. You can see that with each chromosome, this gene is increasing. We can also look at a gene on the Y chromosome and say, okay, we have cells from the blood from people that have one copy of the Y chromosome, two copies, or four copies. And again, with this Y chromosome gene, we see that its level is increasing as you add more Y chromosomes. And these genes are actually involved in turning on or off the expression or the levels of other genes on other chromosomes throughout the whole genome. So you can imagine if you have this kind of regulator, like it's gonna have sort of cascading effects.
And the effects at a cellular level add up inside all of us in some very critical ways, even in how long and how well your own heart pumps.
What we are working with is the part of the heart that is doing most of the pumping work, right in the left ventricle. Heart muscle, it never stops beating, it never gets a break throughout the lifetime. Understanding the pathways or mechanisms that are responsible for these sex differences in heart metabolism, perhaps this is what we can try to regulate pharmaceutically.
We talk a lot nowadays about personalized medicine and how everyone's gonna have their genome sequenced and that's gonna, you know, tell you which medicines you should take and what dose you should get and, you know, what diseases you might be susceptible to in the future. And that is amazing. I think it will be very cool if we can do that.
But a lot of that work has really ignored the X and Y chromosomes. And that is really the biggest genetic difference in our species.
The members of the Page Lab believe that paying attention to these differences, cell by cell, could initiate a sea change in science and medicine.
My hope is that biomedical researchers and clinicians will recognize that sex differences are not an inconvenience to be ignored, but represent a tremendous opportunity to be embraced.